Welcome to worship on this Thursday evening, Maundy, Thursday. Maundy means commandments. It's the day that Christ commanded the partaking of the Lord's Supper. So today we will have Holy Communion, and we'll also begin the 3 days of Christ's Passion. Tonight is the remembrance of the Last Supper. Tomorrow, Good Friday, his death. And then on Easter morning, the resurrection to new life. You're welcome to come to all of those, and either in person here in the sanctuary or also on our online options. It is good to have an option in the sanctuary this year. Last year, we were not here yet. We were still in my living room, so we give thanks that we celebrate here together. Those of you who are in the sanctuary tonight, what that means is that you can sing along, but sing quietly, or hum if you're more comfortable with that. And also stay in your seats for the entire service. Even during communion, you have your communion already with you. And if you haven't used those yet, there's two seals on them. The first one will get you to the bread, and the second one will get you to the grape juice. Those of you at home, if you are wanting to commune, have bread and either wine or grape juice available for you for the end of the service. At the end of the service, we are doing the stripping of the altar, and then we will, the Psalm 22 is chanted for us, and then we will walk out in silence as we observe the Passion of Christ. And then on Easter morning, those of you who also are interested in that, we have two services on Easter Sunday, Driftwood Point at 7 a.m., and then also here in the sanctuary at 9:30 a.m. I'm also going to be, since we're having some sound issues with our uploading to Facebook and Zoom and everything, which you've all been very patient of, but we also will have a pre-packaged, pre-recorded Easter service that will be ready at 6 a.m. on for you to worship with your families as you are able to gather in the Word. So with that, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship with our confession song. Church. God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor and enter the celebration of the great 3 days, reconciled with God and with one another. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you that life is God's gift to you. By his grace and mercy through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Death and sin no longer have their hold over you. In Christ you are a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come.
Amen. Amen.
Let us sing together, Jesus, Jesus, fill us with your love. Love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. Holy God, source of all love, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus gave us a new commandment, to love one another as he loves us. Write this commandment in our hearts and give us the will to serve others, as he was the servant of all. Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll continue by reading Psalm 116 responsively. How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things God has done for me?
I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of God's servant.
O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and a child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds.
I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all God's people.
In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of the people, I will shout hallelujah.
You may be seated.
First reading, Hebrews 9:11-14. But when Christ came as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and perfect hand, not made with hands, that is, not of his creation, he entered once for all into the holy place, not with the blood of the goats and calves, but with his own blood. blood does obtain internal redemption. For if the blood of the goats and bulls, with the sprinkling of the ashes of a heifer, sacrifice those who have been defiled so that their flesh is purified, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from death works to worship the living God? Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to rise once again for the reading of our gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 22nd chapter. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers of the temple police about how he might betray him to them. They were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him to them when no crowd was present. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us, that we may eat it." They asked him, "Where do you want us to make preparations for it?" "Listen," he said to them, "when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters, and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there." So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves, for I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to the one by whom he is betrayed." Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be who would do this. A dispute also arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I am among you as one who serves." This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The day had come of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. The day back in Egypt, in which the final plague that God brought through Moses upon the Egyptians was remembered year after year on that Passover Eve. Remembering how death and life intermingled in the Exodus from slavery, how the blood of the Passover lamb over their doorposts was placed so that the angel of death would not visit their homes as the first firstborn sons were killed throughout Egypt. The bread of haste that had been made was generations ago because there was no time to let it rise as they fled Egypt. God's faithfulness in freeing the beloved people of God from captivity, remember. God's choosing of his people to be their God, remember. Jesus took such care that night that he was betrayed, to have the Passover meal prepared for him and for his disciples. The meal was prepared, the location was set, and they gathered, for he was eager to eat the Passover meal with them before he suffered. In Luke's version of this meal, Jesus takes up a cup and gives thanks, divided it among all the disciples, and shared it, saying that this was the last fruit of the vine consumed by him prior to the cup that was to come, that would be his blood shed for them, for the forgiveness of sins. The law was being fulfilled as he did this. The table is set with great love and with such care by Christ. And then, with simple, clear words, Christ gives them the kingdom again. He took a loaf, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the covenant in my blood." Jesus commanded them, "Do this." Jesus commands us, "Do this." Why? Because we need it. We need this promise bestowed upon us, the promise of forgiveness, the promise that Christ's care and Christ's provision for us, for the disciples in their need, is the same provision and care that we receive, that you receive from your Lord Jesus Christ. Bread that is his body, broken for you. Wine that is his blood, shed for you. The predictions of his death had been given. The coming of the Messiah had long been hoped for and promised, and now it was happening. In this meal, the disciples received the promise of their inheritance in the kingdom of God, an inheritance that is grace, an inheritance that is innocence, an inheritance that is blessedness, an inheritance that is forgiveness, an inheritance that is only ours because of this promise broken and poured out, because it was needed. We don't always like to admit that we need it, this inheritance, this grace. We especially don't like to admit that we need a Lord. Is a term that to our worldly ears angers us as example after example of people lording over one another only leads to more suffering and more injustice in our world. It rings wrong to our ears. We are ill, and we don't like to admit it either. We need this salvation. Just look at this last year. It took a pandemic for many of us to stay home when we were sick. How many of you before last year this time, when you felt a little bad, would go out anyway? Clear guidelines of temperature and symptoms. I mean, we have a long list that we ask you. Whether you still read them or not, we're inundated with it. We know what's on that list. Even when they're clearly out, we deny that we feel bad, or we don't really want to think that we feel bad. We comply, we don't comply. We don't like to admit that we're ill. Might I have corona? Might I have COVID? We are fearful. We've lived a fearful year together. Scripture is more truthful than we are at the reality of sin and death in our life. Our illness is not limited to temperature checks either. COVID can and has taken many lives in this last year. And not only COVID, other things have taken lives this year. Our bodies are frail, and death has become even more real to us this year, at least collectively, than in many other years. We know that power that death has, and that power that will meet each and every one of us. We also live in a world steeped in sin, a world that does not lack sin. It is pervasive all around us. It infects all of us, and no mask or vaccine will be able to defeat that one or vanquish its power over our lives. After all, we can look at all the care and Jesus took that night to have this meal prepared and bestow his promise of what it means to have him as a Lord. But with equal care, Judas, when Satan had entered him, cunningly put Christ up for sale. As Luther remarked, Judas was not summoned by that chief priest or the officers of the temple. He went on his own. And he pocketed 30 pieces of silver. And with his pocket a little heavier, he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. A time that would have as few witnesses as possible, because the city was full of people. And this evil, sinful act would happen in a dark garden where our Lord would be betrayed with a kiss. Judas knew what he was preparing to do, and he let himself be served by Christ in that upper room that night. He took everything that was offered that night. And Jesus knew. He knew of the betrayal, and he spoke of it. He spoke it into the moment of promise as the bread was broken and the cup was poured. Jesus knew their need. That's what happened to Judas. He never got that other word of "I forgive you." When he finally repented, he went to those who didn't give him the word of "you are forgiven." They gave him the word instead of "what's it to us? You already did the act." Predictably, the disciples scramble to figure out who would not measure up, who at that table would be the one who would betray Jesus. Predictable, because we sure do like to compare ourselves to one another, wondering which one of us will it be, which one of us is worse than the other. We like to prove our righteousness, to prove that we are worthy, to prove that by the standards of the world that we're doing well, to convince ourselves, if nothing else, I'm still doing okay. How about you? I'm doing a little better than most people over there, so I'm keep on going. We like to feel like we are winning at the world, at least better than everybody else. It's part of our human nature and our human sin that we do that. And as Luther puts rather bluntly, human righteousness trembles like an aspen leaf. Best to worst, worst to best. Who is worthy among us? Who is not? Is completely missing the point, as our mindset, like the disciples, is stuck in the kingdom of the world. It was not only Judas who betrayed, abandoned, and denied. Jesus was surrounded in the upper room by his disciples, but that wasn't going to last for long. They would all melt away, and we wouldn't have done any different. Do this in remembrance of me. And we do. We're gathered here tonight. We receive bread and wine tonight, and we, as often as we gather, we remember. We remember our need. Just how much our righteousness, our justness trembles and fails. We remember our need because just how much the infection that is sin has permeated into our lives and into our world by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We remember our need and how weary we are, how tired we are of it all right now. We remember our need about just how unexpectedly death can really come. Just how collectively death can claim power over our whole world and bring us to our knees. We remember our need because we don't like to remember it.
we remember also something else tonight. We remember Christ's care and love. We remember Christ's intention and preparation. That night he was betrayed, his love poured out for his disciples, his care for them that they would have the kingdom. We remember Christ's promise through very simple and clear words. This is my body. This is my blood, broken, shed, given. We are commanded to remember. And then we approach the altar, and I know this year we're not going to be approaching the altar. So we'll open those little cups, and we'll hear the words given and shed for you. Not because we are worthy, but because we need this, and the Lord knows it. It is now and has always been given for you. Intentionally, with care, with you in mind, with understanding of how we fall short and how much we need this, it's given for you. Because you need it, you beloved, weary child of God, he prepared all so that you would receive your inheritance. Because you need this grace, you need this forgiveness, you need Christ to take the weight off your shoulders, to hold your heart in his hands and say, I am with you. Tonight, Christ gives you the kingdom once again. It is yours, and you are his. Thanks be to God. Amen. Us your blessedness wrapping around us and holding us close. Continue to remind us that we are yours and that you hold us tight and close. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
And Lord, it's not just us. Our whole world is groaning. Our whole world is in need. We ask that your grace and your peace extend throughout our world into the places where there is war, where there is violence, where there is food scarcity, where there is the need of basic security and life and daily bread. We ask that you provide in your abundance and in your grace. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we ask you to be with those who are on our hearts and our minds today. That you be their strength, that you be their peace, that you be their way forward. We lift before you now, silently or loud, those who we carry in our hearts and our minds this day. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we give thanks that you have seen us through challenging times in the past, and you'll see us through challenging times in the future, that you bring us your kingdom and the hope that comes with it. Cling to us and help us cling to you in all of our needs, blessing us in our lives and in our vocations. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. For offering, I just want to remind you that we give thanks to God also through our generosity, and your generosity as a church makes a difference to fulfill the needs in our community and in our congregation. Now let us listen to the upper room.
Take now and eat, take now and drink.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is our duty and delight that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on the tree of the cross gave salvation to all, that where death began, their life might be restored, and that he, who by a tree once overcame, might by a tree all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us, Lord Jesus Christ, given and shed for you. You may commune.
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. O God, we thank you for gathering and feeding us as a mother hen embraces her young. Release us now to go on our way in these 40 days, ready to see our work as prayer, ready to fast from complacency, and ready to share with those in need, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
to seek the Lord, give praise, and may your hearts